All right, so that gets us to the end of talking about VC dimension. So, Charles, what did we learn?
Well, we learned about VC dimension. I think that was probably the key thing.
Indeed, which was capturing this notion of shattering.
Right. We learned that VC dimension, the relationship between VC dimensions, VC dimension and parameters.
Yeah, very good. And in fact, so like we'd even be able to have a guess to say, well, what if you have a neural network and you're thinking of adding additional nodes to the hidden layer? What do we suppose that would do to the VC dimension of what you can represent?
So we didn't really talk about it, but it does occur to me when you put it that way that it's pretty subtle, right? Because it's not just that it's related to the number of parameters. It's related to the true number of parameters, because you can always come up with inefficient ways to represent your parameters. So, for example, if you have a real number, I could represent that as two parameters, everything to the left of the decimal point and everything to the right of the decimal point. But that doesn't make it really two separate parameters. It's still just one parameter.
All right. That's fair.
We also saw how VC relates to the size of the hypothesis space for finite hypothesis spaces. And I guess we learned how sample complexity relates to VC dimension. And, in fact, all these things are themselves related. And we learned a little bit, some tricks, or at least went through some examples of how to actually compute the VC dimension. In particular, we learned that you need to give an example to find the lower bound, and you need to prove an upper bound.
Good. And one other thing that I'd want to add to that is that VC dimension captures this notion of pack learnability. Cool. I think that's enough for one session.
All right. See you next time, Michael. Bye.
All right. See you next time.